Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to tonight's regularly scheduled City Council meeting. The meeting is called to order. I kindly ask our city clerk to please take the roll call.
Mike Bruno.
Here.
Tara Burghardt.
Here.
Don Cummings.
Here.
Dean Kilburg.
Here.
Craig Maladra.
Here.
Richard Marks.
Here.
Jim Radecki.
Here.
Mary Sino.
Here.
Tom Simonian.
Here.
Ron Singer.
Here.
For the benefit of those in attendance and those tuning in, Alderman Maladra is calling in by phone, which is permitted by Illinois statute. So when he is called upon to either make a comment and or vote, he will state his name, make his comment, and or state his name and cast his vote. So, gentlemen of Cub Scout Pack number 11, Weeblow's Den, Harrison Street Elementary School, where are you? Oh, good God, they're right there. Do we have a spokesperson? One person who wants to come to the podium and answer any questions? Okay, then. Yes, sir. Come on up. Sean, is that correct?
No.
Shucks.
Right here.
Dominic?
Yeah.
Dominic, you're the spokesperson for the entire group, right?
Okay.
You were here earlier this evening to learn a little bit about the city? We hung out at my office and talked about all sorts of stuff?
Yeah.
Anything you want to share with the group assembled and everybody watching you on television? This is your chance, man.
I don't know.
Did you enjoy yourself?
Yeah.
Did you? We weren't able to see inside the safe, though, were we?
No.
Because I don't have the combination.
No.
Now, usually the Girl Scouts bring cookies. What do you guys have?
Popcorn.
Shucks, I shouldn't have said that. Well, we have the City of St. Charles credit card, so we're going to buy a whole bunch of popcorn. Do you want to invite your colleagues up to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Yeah.
Awesome. And gentlemen, we'll follow your lead, okay? Whenever you're ready, gentlemen.
Ready, three. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well done, gentlemen. Dominic, any last parting remarks? Heads up, photo op. Oh, you're welcome. 9, 10, and almost 11-year-olds, Harrison Street Elementary School.
Guy on the left there. He's
any last comments you'd like to share with the community?
Are we on TV?
Answer them.
You are on TV.
On the news?
Let's hope not.
Aww.
You guys know what the FCC is?
No.
Okay, Google it. The news. Now, you guys are on TV, man, so when you go home, you can watch this thing tomorrow. It'll be awesome. If it's blacked out, don't be surprised.
Hi, Mom. Aww.
Gentlemen, we're proud that you were here tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We move on to item 3, ladies and gentlemen. 3A, we have the pleasure of introducing our finance manager, Rita Cruz, who will make a presentation of our special guest this evening. Ms. Cruz, welcome.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. The city has received the budget award and the CAFR, or Comprehensive Final Annual Report, for the past 7 years and 4 years, respectively. In 2016, the city embarked on the PAFR, or Popular Annual Financial Report. The PAFR is a report which is readily accessible and easily understandable to the general public and other interested parties without a background in public finance. The publishing of the PAFR was the Finance Division's goals for fiscal year 2017. While I was in my master's at NIU, there were interns working on the PAFR project, for their respective municipalities. I realize this would be a great project for the city's administrator's intern because it would allow him to complete a project from start to finish, and it could be used for his career portfolio. With the city administrator's approval, Chris Rainey completed the project and received the award for the city. Kudos to Chris for doing a wonderful job. Dr. Brian Caputo, CFO of the College of DuPage, is here to present the Caffer and Paffer Awards to the City of Geneva.
Good evening, Mr. Caputo.
Good evening, Mayor. Good evening. I am here tonight on behalf of the Government Finance Officers Association to present two significant awards to the City of Geneva. First, the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting. Since 1946, the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting has been the highest form of recognition in the area of governmental accounting and financial reporting. To receive the certificate, the applicant must submit its comprehensive annual financial report for an in-depth review and evaluation by two members selected from a panel of government finance officers, independent certified public accountants, educators, and others with specialized expertise and experience in governmental accounting and financial reporting. Reports are also evaluated by members of the GFOA's professional staff. The program's demand and criteria require the preparation and disclosure of considerably more financial information that is mandated under generally accepted accounting principles. Only those reports judged by all reviewers to have substantially met the program's criteria are awarded the Certificate of Achievement. Receipt of the certificate represents a significant accomplishment by a government and its management. Only about 5% of the governments in the country receive the Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting each year. To Rita Cruz, I'd like to present the CAFR Award for the fiscal year ended April 30th, 2016. This marks the fourth consecutive time that the City of Geneva has received this prestigious award. Rita?
Congratulations.
Was established by the GFOA in 1991 to encourage and assist state and local governments to extract information from their comprehensive annual financial report and to produce high-quality, popular reports specifically designed to be readily accessible and easily understandable to the general public and others interested in public finance, and then to recognize individuals in the government that have achieved the goal. Popular annual financial reports submitted to the PAFR program are reviewed by selected members of the GFOA professional staff and by outside reviewers in a fashion similar to the CAFR award. These individuals have experience in governmental accounting and financial reporting. Less than 0.5% of governments in the United States receive the GFOA's award for outstanding achievement in popular annual financial reporting each year. Indeed, the City of Geneva is one of only 13 municipalities in Illinois to receive this award. And I will add that because the city has received the CAFR award, also received the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award, and now the PAFR award, I say it represents a bit of a professional trifecta for the city. Certainly, the city's finance division and the administrator's office played a central role in earning all of these awards. However, the staff could not have done this without the support of the mayor and city council. So I thank you for your commitment to excellence in financial management. Right now, I'd like to present the PAFR award to Chris Rainey.
Hey, Chris, before you sit down, would you want to introduce yourself to everybody?
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Chris Rainey, and I am the administrative intern here with the City of Geneva. And I'm also a student at NIU going for my master's in public administration.
How excited are you to receive this recognition?
Very excited. This is actually a great project I was given, and I'm very glad that we got this award.
Congratulations, and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Cruz, do you want to add anything else? All good? That's a good way to kick off the meeting. Ladies and gentlemen, we move to item 3B as in boy, and that is the fiscal year 2017-2018 budget presentation. Our city administrator, Mrs. Dawkins, is going to walk through the presentation. Ms. Dawkins, I would assume as before, do you want to get through the entire presentation, or are you more comfortable taking questions as we go?
I would prefer if we hold all questions, because this is really more just of an overview.
Okay.
Most of the council only got the new numbers late last week.
Right.
So we're really not anticipating that you've had a chance to delve into them. We really just kind of want to give you that 30,000 foot to give you some more information if you had questions as you reviewed the budget.
And just as a reminder to the council and the community, we're not taking action on the budget this evening. We're simply making a recommendation to state the public hearing for the budget.
Right, and that's an actual action item on your agenda later.
Correct.
So good evening, Mayor, City Council, and citizens of Geneva. This evening, as I just mentioned, we're going to present an overview of the budget. Some of this may seem elementary, but it's really just to give those who have not been through a budget process, much like the general public, an idea of what the budget entails and how we go about formulating the budget. So we'll start with the city budget. Essentially, a city budget, we all know what a budget is. Some of us have a household budget, others of us have a budget at work, but Merriam-Webster would define a budget as a plan for the coordination of resources and expenditures. But the budget also, in regards to the city, establishes the level of services that we provide. Services such as how quickly first responders respond, how frequently snow plows are deployed during a snow event, how often the streets are swept, how quickly an inspection can be made and permits can be approved. All of those are things that are tied into the budget. It defines capital improvements that will be made within the fiscal year, and it represents the collective priorities of the government body regarding municipal services. And a budget should also plan for the future. There are state laws and regulations that we have to abide to when we are looking at the city budget. First of all, it must be adopted before the beginning of the fiscal year to which it applies. Before its passage, you must make the tentative budget available for public inspection. Currently, the draft budget is available on the city's website. There's also a hard copy at City Hall if somebody wanted to come in and look at it. And then as we continue to refine and revise the budget, those updated documents will also be available on the city website. You have to hold a public hearing. Tonight, we are asking that the council set the date for that public hearing so the public is aware of the date they can come and make comment on the budget. It prohibits deficit spending. In other words, you cannot have expenditures that exceed your revenues. Your revenues can be cash on hand, it can be using some fund balance, but ultimately you can't spend more than you have. And that's what a balanced budget is. Estimated revenues minus estimated expenses is either zero or greater. So you're allowed to have more revenue than expenses, but you can't have more expenses than revenue. The city budget basics, our budget is for a fiscal year. The city's fiscal year runs May 1st through April 30th. It's an estimate that considers the past financial history. We gather information from others, including the Illinois Municipal League, Kane County. That's how we make some of our projections. We look at the goals of the governing body that were set during our strategic planning workshop. We look at the economic conditions, and we also look at the state of Illinois. So a budget may change from year to year. Sometimes it increases, sometimes it decreases. What causes these changes? These changes might be created when there are new funds created. So for example, last year we added an SSA for On Brentwood's Pond. So that increased the budget because a new fund was added and there were expenses that they wanted to make to better their neighborhood. There might be new sources of revenue. We've had a lot of discussion over the past several months about new sources of revenue. There are contractual obligations. These contractual obligations can either be from collective bargaining agreements, they could be just regular contractual obligations that you have for services, maybe it's landscaping services, maybe it's janitorial services. There are public safety pension obligations. These obligations are set forth by state statute. We're told by an actuary the amount that we need to budget for pension obligations. Capital spending, if you invest more in your capital, your budget's gonna go up. If you invest less, your budget may go down. And then there's always the possibility of new projects and priorities. So again, just a little bit on the new funds. We created SSA number 32 last year. This year we added a fund for TIF number 3 that was created back last fall. The two funds will increase the overall budget, but have no impact on the general fund and it has no impact on an individual's property tax bill unless subject to the SSA. I should also mention that the city's budget is not just one budget. The city's budget is actually 37 individual budgets that make up what we call the city budget. But of those 37 different budgets, you can't intermingle. So you're balancing each individual fund on its own accord. In putting together the budget, there are always some challenges. I would also hazard that there are some opportunities, but right now the challenges are we've had some federal and state unfounded mandates. We've been talking about some upgrades to the wastewater treatment plant as an example. We have aging infrastructure and equipment. We talked about recently replacing a couple vehicles that were literally rusting out. Currently, there's been a lack of state budget, which is going on nearly 2 years. And with that lack of a state budget, we've seen a decline or a delay in state shared revenues. We've heard about threats to local government distributive funds, which is basically the income tax share that the municipalities get. And we've also heard threats of a property tax freeze, anywhere from 2 years to a permanent property tax freeze. I always point that out because the state is threatening, and I use it as a threat to freeze property taxes, which sounds good, but that does not help the state's budget. The state receives no dollars from local property taxes. Local property taxes only go to those taxing bodies on your tax bill, of which the city's portion is about 8%. So these are a lot of numbers. I don't expect you to write them all down and look at them, but I wanted to give kind of a visual of where we started and where we are today. The first column lists all the funds. So those are the 37 different funds of the city. There are different types of funds, and if you read our popular annual financial report, you'll learn what types of funds those are. The first column is what we call the amended fiscal year 17 budget. So that was the budget that was passed last year. It may have been amended throughout the year because sometimes things change. You either get a grant that you didn't account for or an expenditure you didn't account for. The projected budget is where we think we're going to finish the year. It's really just an estimate. We're still a month and a half away from the end of the fiscal year, so those numbers can still change. And then the third column is the what I'm calling the original request. That is the budget that was sent to the City Council back at the end of February for them to have an opportunity to start looking at what staff's recommendations were and to try to get feedback and see if we were on the same page. And then lastly, the last column is showing what we're calling the amended request, which is the budget that just went out within the packet that is currently posted on the city's website. So our process begins in November with strategic planning. This is attended by the City Council, department heads, and the Strategic Plan Advisory Committee chairman. It is at this meeting that the city's strategic plan is reviewed and priorities are established for the upcoming year. Following that, in December, the city passes the annual tax levy. Approximately 30% of the general fund revenues come from property taxes. The remainder comes from sales tax, municipal tax, state income tax, and other. The general fund, again, I remind you, are typically what core city services are provided out of the general fund. So that's your police services, your fire services, your public works, street and fleet services, just general government services. Beginning in January, professional staff meets to discuss budget standards and begins the process of building the budget. This year, we had a special committee of the whole meeting on January 30th with the City Council to receive direction on several items prior to preparing the initial draft budget. In late February, a draft budget was distributed to the City Council members for their review and comment. Since the draft was distributed, the City Council directed staff to prepare an ordinance to rescind the places for eating tax. As such, the draft budget being presented this evening has been revised to eliminate any anticipated revenue from the places for eating tax. A few highlights. So the budget that you see before you this evening is balanced. Again, revenues greater than expenditures or equal to. It addresses priorities set by the City Council in November. A couple of those priorities are, and you'll note later in the budget, was money for a Southeast Master Plan TIF study. That's the industrial park we're looking at. And also downtown zoning ordinance update. We talked about hiring a consultant to take the downtown station area master plan and the zoning layers there and update our ordinance. Both of these items were identified in strategic planning as priority one goals. In addition, the Infrastructure Capital Fund anticipates expenditures relating to an annual pavement marking program, which addresses a priority two goal of the City Council to evaluate access improvements and pedestrian crossings. The budget also has some personnel considerations. The following are included in the proposed budget: moving the preservation planner from part-time to full-time, creating a position of the combo building inspector. This is in lieu of having independent contractors. We currently have an independent contractor as a building inspector, and we also have independent contractors as plumbing inspectors. We would now hire one person to do both those jobs. The cost of that position is actually offset by the cost we were paying contractors. It includes the addition of a firefighter paramedic position. That was an agreement in the collective bargaining with the firefighters back when we reorganized the department to add three battalion chiefs. It created three vacancies that we have left unfilled until this last year and this year. It also adds a utility locator. That position is paid for out of the enterprise funds, your electric fund, and your water and wastewater fund. It does not affect the general fund. There is no increase budgeted for non-union unrepresented personnel. As we discussed in January, we are embarking on a compensation and classification study with a consultant to kind of take a look at our classification and compensation plan and see if any changes should be made for those personnel. And there's no increase in health premiums budgeted. Lastly, over the weekend, City Council was provided with a document that outlines all of the various reductions to the general fund and impacts to other funds based on reduction in anticipated revenues to the general fund by the elimination of the places for eating tax. And in short terms, it's basically a $200,000 reduction in the general fund, but a $700,000 reduction if you look at all funds. A quick slide here just to show you a little about the positions. It sounds like maybe we're adding a lot of positions, but what this chart shows is the top line are full-time positions in the city across all funds. So you'll see back in fiscal year 09, we had we had 155 budgeted full-time employees. And for fiscal year 18, we're proposing 150 full-time employees. The charts below break out where those employees' kind of home base is. So the big green line is your general fund. So typically that's got your most employees because, again, that's your police, your fire, your general government employees. The yellow line is your electric fund employees. And the orange line is your water, wastewater utility employees. You'll notice the changes in fiscal year 14, the council authorized the addition of a communications coordinator position in the city administrator's office. That was based on a staffing analysis that was done that time that said that we would benefit from a position such as that. In fiscal year 16, the council authorized the addition of an electric apprentice in the electric division because we were getting ready to see some retirements, and it takes a while for an electric apprentice to kind of go through the process and become a lineman. In 17, we authorized the hiring of two firefighters, like I mentioned, to fill the vacancies that were created with the reorganization to create the battalion chief position. And they also approved an electric apprentice. So we now have two electric apprentices because, again, we're seeing retirements. We actually have one lineman vacancy right now. And then fiscal year 18 is as we previously discussed just a few minutes ago. So just a few highlights, looking at the three major funds. There are 37 funds. A lot of them are very small funds. Some of them are just set by either the tax levy based upon what homeowners want to do in the SSA. Some of them are pension obligations. So we look mainly, the budget is really comprised of these three major funds. The first is the general fund. What this chart shows again is fiscal year 17 amended, projected, and then requested in that order. So you'll see it's pretty much of a flat budget. The largest increase is approximately 2% in personnel services, which is attributable to collective bargaining wage increases for police, fire, and streets and fleet, the addition of personnel, and an increase in the required contributions for the police fire pension. The last column there, other financing uses, this is actually the last year you'll see that unless, of course, we incur more debt. But that is the final payment on the fire truck. We did that over a several year process, so next year we'll have the last payment on the fire pumper truck. And then it'll be time to buy a new fire truck. And then I thought it might be interesting for you all to see how the money is spent in the general fund, for what types of services. So this breaks it out by department. I combined general government, which is legislative, which is the mayor and city council, the Board of Fire and Police Commission, the city administrator's office, and administrative services, which includes human resources, IT, and finance. So that's your general government category. Then you have the other departments, community development, economic development, police, fire, and public works. But in public works, all we're talking about is streets, fleets, engineering, and storm drainage. We're not talking electric or water and wastewater because, again, those are their own separate utility fund. So, and again, you can see the increases are traditionally in police and fire. I would attribute those again mostly to either increased pension costs or increased personnel contractual obligations. Looking at the electric fund, you have a big spike. Similar type of charts. We break it out by the types of fund spending we're doing. So you're either spending it on people, contractual, commodities, debt service, capital, or other expenditures. You see quite a large column there in the second column. That's your purchase power. So purchase power accounts for the largest share of the electric fund for a total of roughly $31 million. This is directly related to customer sales. So if you're selling electricity, you have to buy electricity. So that's our purchasing of the electricity so that then we turn around and sell it. Personal service increase is mainly attributed to the implementation of GASB 67 and 68, which is a government accounting thing. And thing is a technical term, right, Rita? which became effective April 30th of 2016. So this is a new thing that we have to implement this coming year. The new reporting standard requires that the city to account for future pension costs in the current year with pension costs based upon an actuary study. So very similar to what we do with police and fire. Now we're having to do that in our enterprise funds. So your water and wastewater fund, this one, you see the huge spike is under the capital outlay column. So that shouldn't surprise you since we just recently approved to get an IEPA loan, and that's for roughly $10 million for wastewater treatment plant upgrades. There's a couple other capital projects in there as well. And then again, the water fund also has to comply with GASB 67 and 68. So the slight increase you see in personal services there is for that, and also the new utility locator position, part of that person's salary would be here. There are no increases budgeted here because all the water and sewer employees are not unionized. So overall wages are budgeted as flat in that fund. Then to talk a little bit about where most of the city's money goes, capital. You got to invest in what you have so you can keep on moving. So this is just a quick little pie chart that shows capital investment of all funds combined. You'll see the water wastewater obviously is the largest chunk of the pie with $13 million. Miscellaneous funds, so that might be our PEG fund or that we get from franchise fees. It could be SSAs if they're looking to rebuild a culvert or something that would be considered a capital project. The electric has about $2.5 million in capital planned. General capital projects is $102,000. That was where I was talking about the SEMP study would go there. The downtown zoning ordinance would come out of that fund. Infrastructure capital, we're looking at about $3 million. That's your streets. That's also looking at pedestrian safety. Those kinds of things come out of the infrastructure. And lastly, capital equipment is anything that is machinery, equipment, or vehicles that support the general fund. So again, not your electric or your water or wastewater, but it could be a police squad car, it could be a fire truck, it could be a snow plow. That's what would come out of the capital equipment fund. So a few little trends on capital. You'll see that general capital projects, we see a trend that it's decreasing. Basically, this is because general capital projects is funded by a transfer from the general fund. So if you don't have money in the general fund to transfer to general capital, then general capital doesn't happen. 14 through 16 are actually artificially high because it wasn't until this year that we actually budgeted in the capital equipment fund because we didn't have any money in there for a while. We were building up money. So capital equipment actually used to come out of this fund. If you take that out, it was approximately $1.3 million in expenditures over that period of time. That was really for capital equipment, not for capital projects. But we wanted to show you how it's actually reflected in our financials, so that's why it's a little artificially high here. And you'll see in another slide where that shows. Infrastructure, basically, infrastructure capital is primarily funded by the 0.5% non-home rule sales tax referendum that the city passed. So that's a pretty reliable source of funding, so those projects stay pretty consistent over the years. The forecast is, again, if we had to push a little bit this year, so that gets pushed out to the future years, so you see a spike, but then as you budget that year, maybe it'll come back down and it might push it further out. It just depends what your priorities are in any given particular year. And then lastly, the capital equipment fund. This is where you see 14, 15, and 16. There's zero because those dollars were actually expended out of the capital projects fund. Now we have a fund that's set solely for machinery, vehicles, and equipment. You'll see we look at spending for projected 17 and 18 is pretty similar. Typically, the council had a policy that anytime we sold city assets or city property, that money would go into the capital equipment fund as kind of seed money. And so last year, or this current year that we're in, we spent that seed money. We had sold a little bit and we had a little bit of money in there. So this year we decided to spend it. Next year, it's really only being funded by a transfer from the general fund. So again, much like capital projects, if you don't have the money in the general fund, you don't have money in the capital equipment funds. Again, you see a huge spike in 19. If you remember back to strategic planning, we gave you a list of kind of all the capital. We had done like a five-year plan and said we need X number of vehicles this year, X number of vehicles this year, X number of vehicles this year. If you need four vehicles this year and only buy two, that pushes two to the next year. So those two get added on to that year. And then depending upon what you do, it gets pushed out. So as you go, you'll see these spikes. So 20 looks low, but if you don't fund everything in 19, you'll see a spike in 20. And I will point out that currently, right now, we do not have a dedicated source of revenue other than if we sell city property. And I don't know how much more city property we have to sell. Looking at capital trends for electric, capital equipment has traditionally been funded. Oh, sorry, wrong slide. We talked about that. Electric capital expenses are based upon maintaining the current infrastructure and expansion as needed to new development. As you see, they keep it relatively level depending upon what's going on. The last few years, some of their big projects have been the undergrounding cable projects. In the Water and Wastewater Fund, you'll see they're relatively consistent over the years with the exception of the spike we're looking at next year, which again, that is all the wastewater treatment plant upgrades, which are due to EPA mandates. So kind of the last word on the budget, which really isn't the last word because it's not my last slide, but just because it's in the budget doesn't mean it can or will be spent. You must have cash to pay for the item. Estimates are only as good as the estimator's ability to predict the future. So the next steps. The proposed budget is a recommendation from professional staff based upon the input provided by the City Council at strategic planning and in other meetings. Although balanced, it does not purport to address all current and future needs. Rather, the budget has been balanced as required by law. This budget does not reflect any decrease in state funding, although it has been contemplated and contingency plans have been discussed. Should we experience a significant loss of revenue, we would make internal adjustments and operating budgets as needed and ask for the Council's direction on specific program areas that would have to be terminated or reduced. Like other organizations, we will use the budget as a financial plan, a business strategy, and a blueprint to guide us in the coming fiscal year. However, it is only that. It is a plan to move us forward. It can be changed by the City Council as the need arises. As a result of public policy principles and strategies established by the City Council, as well as the challenging work of our professional and dedicated staff, a balanced line item budget has been presented to you for fiscal year 18. So this evening, I do have city staff available to answer questions you may have, or you may wish to do this at another meeting. Like I said, you may not have had time to review the whole budget. The budget schedule did contemplate time for discussion and deliberation prior to any final action. So what we would ask tonight is just to set the public hearing, which is item 9A on the agenda. And then I kind of wanted a little bit of feedback on the process moving forward. We have two ideas. We have several Mondays before we get to April 17th, so we can either set aside at the end of every City Council or CAL meeting kind of budget discussion. If we go that route, my only request would be that we determine, like, if we're talking about general fund one night, maybe electric fund another night, so we have the appropriate staff available. Otherwise, the council could also maybe choose to set a special committee of the whole meeting, one night solely dedicated to talking about the budget. Again, that's however you all wish to proceed is good with us. We are available to do whatever you would like. I did mention that there were reductions. I have spoken with some of you over the last few days. I provided a list of those reductions. I won't go through all of those. Some of the big things were we are recommending eliminating year two of the phased in welcome signs. There's a little bit of money left in tourism for welcome signs, but not the whole year two of the phased in project. We also recommended eliminating the downtown market pavilion. We really feel we were anticipating getting revenue for that project things have changed a little bit over the years, and we really would like to have a discussion with the City Council whether that's truly still a want and something we want to look at. And we also proposed what's called, and it's not my name, it's called a Big Belly garbage system for downtown. Very similar for those of you who maybe have been at Navy Pier. It's a trash compacting system with also a recycle, and it sends through some kind of sensor to Public Works when the trash are getting filled, but it also compacts so it holds more trash. We had anticipated implementing a system like that, but due to other changes, that was eliminated. So again, this evening, we're open to any questions you might have, and that is the overview.
Thank you, Stephanie. Ladies and gentlemen from the dais, questions or comments for the city administrator? Alderman Singer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Stephanie, where does the reserve enter into the aspect of the budget?
So the City Council passed a financial policy that said we would keep 25% in reserves. This budget for the general fund will show a reserve balance of 26.6%.
And how can those reserves be drawn out, in what manner or form?
They can be drawn out by action of the City Council.
Okay. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Alderman Radecki.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, Stephanie, thank you. That's a lot of work, and thanks to Rita and your whole group, and that was a very good presentation, and I know this is very high level. So I'm going to ask a very high level question, and it's related to a topic that we're going to be discussing in a couple of minutes. Number one, I guess, removing the places for eating tax, does that present a significant threat, in your opinion, to the city? And if it does, what would you say would have the major impact? From what I saw just now, it looks like capital equipment, but I'd like to hear your comments about that.
Sure. Capital equipment definitely is impacted. We cut $581,000 from capital projects, so that was the infrastructure fund, the general capital fund, and the capital equipment fund in order to make the budget balance. I think what it does more than that is looking long-term. You may be able to budget for a year, but you're not planning for the future. And a budget should be planning for a future, so every year you're not trying to either catch up from last year or future years. And there's no contemplation in this budget for what happens if the state does reduce our local government distributed funds. There's been talk anywhere from 50% down to 10%, but any amount, that's about $2 million in our budget, any amount would hurt.
To that point, in addition, no state budget for a year, property tax
almost
freeze, 2 years, property tax freeze potentially looming, delay in shared revenue, some of the other things that are the fallout from the state. Those are threats.
Those are all threats.
Thank you.
Anyone else on the dais? Otherwise, Alderman Simonian.
Thank you, Mayor. My desire of this budget would be, one, that we change it to a fiscal year, a calendar year instead of a fiscal year, and then at all our major contractual relationships, like, for instance, benefits, fall in those same cycles. So it's much easier to manage on a calendar year, number one, and two, contracts that we have on that same calendar year, so we're not halfway through years and trying to figure out, we don't know what the last 6 months of the budget's going to be because we don't know what the contract is because the contract starts in November versus starting at our fiscal. So I don't know what the appetite is of the council, but I would like to pursue looking into changing this budget to a calendar year budget and changing some of these contracts that we can change to follow that same calendar year. So the budget numbers stay. We're comparing apples to apples. On a regular basis, because I just don't see what sense it makes to have a $2.5 million contract for our benefits expiring October 31st when our fiscal year starts May 1st, and I would think benefit contracts would want to be on a calendar year as well for deductible reasons, etc. So just my 2 cents. Oh, and I've got a couple other questions. The 2016.
I believe that historically that's what Illinois municipalities have. I don't believe that there's other rationale other than that was the historic fiscal year date for municipalities.
I notice here the 2016-17 budget estimate of what we budgeted, and then the same 2016-17 projected is a $1.26 million surplus.
I'm sorry, I missed the first part.
The 2016-2017 budget of $17.314 million and the projected ending budget for that 2016-2017 year is $16.054 million. So it shows a $1.26 million surplus.
And again, potentially, we still have time to go, so there may be some unforeseen things. There may have been a capital project, or there may have been a project that didn't get done that got pushed. You know, I don't know all the details of why the estimate came in where it did, but yes, whatever is left, whatever we anticipate being left over that's above that 25% was then figured in to the revenues for 2018.
So you figured in 1.26 million?
We figured in whatever was left. I don't know what that number is off the top of my head, because we still had to make sure that we had 25% in reserves. And when we finished last year, we were at, I think, 23, 20, we were right close to there, 20, 24, 25. So first we make sure that we have the 25% reserves. Then what's ever left is basically what we can feel we can spend the following year if need be.
Okay, so let me see if I got this correct. The whatever is left in the previous year's budget is calculated as revenue for the following year's budget?
Anything above and beyond, if we need it, anything above and beyond that 25%.
Okay.
First and foremost, we make sure that we have the 25% fund balance reserve.
Right.
And then the rest, if when we figure out our expenses, so you'll see in the request that came out, there was we took $267,000 out of fund balance to balance this year's budget, this projected budget.
So what number are you using, are you calculating as revenue from last year's budget? Are you using, is there a number that you're using in the current budget?
We estimate all of the revenues based on history trends, based on IML, what they say. So we start every year basically from scratch, and we look at what does IML say that the trends are. We look at what the history has been the past few years. We look at whether there's new building, maybe there's some more development, maybe there's more permit fees, but we look at those each individually each year as we build the budget.
But you're using some number as a number, correct? I mean, you can't provide us with these numbers without using some revenue number as an estimate.
Right, we start with the estimate, which is what I gave you in January. We sit down and we go through all of our revenue sources and we estimate what we believe those will bring in. Then we go through and estimate all of our expenses. If our expenses are exceeding our revenues, we have a gap. Then we.
I'm just talking about the difference between the budgeted 2016-2017 budget and the end projected. What's listed here is shows a $1.26
right.
million dollar. Of that $1.26 million, you're saying that some portion of that after reserves goes into as a revenue line item into the.
If we need it, yes.
What do you mean if we need it?
If our expenditures are less than our revenues, we don't need to add any in the revenues because we have no gap.
Okay, well, then share with me what happens to that money. I don't know what happens
to
that.
It stays in the reserves. It stays in your fund balance.
And so reserves go up.
So your reserves grow.
So right now we're at 26.3,
you said? 26.6, I believe.
Six. So our reserves are 200.
26.6 with this budget? I thought what we projected at the end of this budget we're proposing will be at 26.6 fund balance. Yes.
The other thing that you do need to look at is if you look at the revenues, which I don't have a page number on your PDF, is the budget for general fund revenues was $17.3 million, and we're projecting only $16.0.
That's the revenues coming in. So that means we're getting less revenues than we thought we would. So we can't spend.
Are you talking about 2016-17?
So your question between, thank you, Rita, 18. Between budget and projected.
Yes.
We budgeted $17.3 million in revenues.
Right.
We are projecting that we will only take in $16 million in revenues. Therefore, we would have had to not spend so that we're not spending more than we have without drawing down the fund balance. So we're projecting our spend to be, oops, my pages are out of order. I apologize.
I'm looking at the expenditure budget.
Right,
not the revenue.
But you have to look at both sides. Because your expenditures are down because your revenues are down. And if you remember my last slide said, if you don't have the cash, you can't spend it. So there are things that weren't spent because the revenues weren't coming in as we anticipated.
Okay. If then we overestimated revenues then. Because if you're saying the
sure.
We estimated revenues at 17.3 and sure. They actually came in at 16.4.
Again, we do the best we can with the information we have. We don't have a magic crystal ball as, again, you know.
So there's not $1.26 million in surplus.
No, it all depends on where the year ends with the revenues that we collect and the expenditures that we spend. So the reality is you won't know that exact dollar amount until after the auditors come in and audit our books.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Alderman Maladra, do you have any comments or questions before I recognize Alderman Bruno?
I do not, thank you.
Alderman Bruno.
Thank you, Mayor. First, a little callback, shout out to city staff on our reporting awards. You guys do a terrific job. And to answer your question, Stephanie, about my inclination would be to have separate special cows to discuss the budget, but I'll go with the will. Thank you.
From the dais. Alderman Maladra? Nothing? Anyone from the audience? Should we take a consensus with respect to hosting additional meetings moving forward? We want a special committee of the whole meeting. Does anyone object to having those special committee of the whole meetings on our regularly scheduled Monday evenings, or do you prefer a different evening of the week? I was thinking Sunday afternoon. I mean,
I would prefer a separate
evening.
Yeah, I think if we try to do it in one special, it'll get, I'd rather break it up, and this way you can have the department heads here, you know, when they need to be. So I think that makes more sense.
Should we survey you electronically with respect to either a Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday evening? We could have that survey out tomorrow morning, first thing.
Sure.
And would you prefer, so I think what I'm hearing you say, Alderman Radecki, is do maybe general fund at one meeting and maybe one or both of the enterprise funds at another meeting? And then all the miscellaneous stuff is primarily, we can do either.
Sure, whatever break you think
okay. Makes
it the most sense that.
But not to try to do them all
at
once.
Yeah, I think we'll get sloppy at the end.
You know. Split it up.
Alderman Kilbrey.
So what you're proposing is that we do this then as a part of our regular meetings on Monday evenings, or are you?
Yeah, that's what you were proposing.
No, he was saying a different night.
Up to the council.
Yeah, I thought we almost agreed on something, Bruno. That's unbelievable.
just need to clarify it.
So we could actually do a combination. So the general fund, I think, obviously is the biggest fund. Not the biggest fund of dollars-wise, but the biggest impact as far as property tax, sales tax, and all of that. So we could do that on a separate evening. Perhaps the enterprise funds on a lighter council night, we could carve out at the end of those meetings a special for it to handle the enterprise funds. In either order, it doesn't matter. They're all.
Alderman Kilbert?
Could we consider a Saturday for the larger meeting on the general fund? A Saturday morning, possibly?
Sure.
I think the one thing that we encounter when we start scheduling meetings at short notice here over the next 3 to 4 weeks is that people have work and travel commitments on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday evenings through the middle of the week. And I think we need to be respectful of that. And I would make myself available on a Saturday if that would be something that the council would want to consider. Thank you.
If there's no objection, I can have Ms. Fornari contact everyone electronically and just to kind of gauge the availability, including the Saturday morning. Anything else, Alderman Maladra, before we move on?
No, sir.
That was item 3B, folks. There's no action being taken tonight. As discussed earlier, we're on to item 4, which is amendments to the agenda. Are there any amendments offered by the City Council and or our guests this evening? Hearing none. Alderman Maladra, anything? Okay. Item 5 is the omnibus agenda. All items marked with an asterisk are considered to be routine by this City Council and can be considered and acted upon with one motion.
So moved.
Second. Alderman Bruno makes the motion to approve the consent agenda, seconded by Alderman Sino. Any questions or comments from the dais? Alderman Maladra, any questions or comments regarding the consent agenda?
None.
From the audience? Mr. Clerk, please take the roll.
Jim Radecki?
Aye.
Mary Sino?
Aye.
Tom Simonian?
Aye.
Ron Singer?
Aye.
Mike Bruno?
Aye.
Tara Burkhart?
Aye.
Don Cummins?
Aye.
Dean Kilberg?
Aye.
Craig Maladra?
Alderman Maladra votes aye.
Richard Marks?
Aye.
Item number 5 passes unanimously. We skip down to item number 9, which is other items and correspondence, and that is 9A is to recommend setting the fiscal year 2017-2018 budget hearing for Monday, April 17, 2017.
So moved. Second.
Alderman Kilberg makes the motion. Is that Alderman Marks makes the second? Questions or comments from anyone in the dais or anyone in the audience or Alderman Maladra on the phone? Hearing none, we'll take a roll call vote. Mr. Clerk.
Jim Radecki?
Aye.
Mary Sino?
Aye.
Tom Simonian?
Aye.
Ron Singer?
Aye.
Mike Bruno?
Aye.
Tara Burkhart?
Aye.
Don Cummins?
Aye.
Dean Kilberg?
Aye.
Craig Maladra?
Alderman Maladra votes aye.
Richard Marks?
Aye.
Item number 9A passes unanimously. Item 10 is municipal bills for payment. We kindly ask our city clerk to read the bills in their aggregate for our consideration this evening.
Bills for payment total $2,000,000. $504,238.67.
Mr. Mayor, I move we approve and pay the bills as read. The individual items that add up to that amount can be found in tonight's packet on the city website.
Alderman Bruno makes the motion to pay the bills as presented.
Second.
Seconded by Alderman Marks. These bills are available on the city's website and in our packet this evening. Any questions or comments regarding the bills as presented from anyone in the audience? At the dais? On the phone, Alderman Maladra?
Nope.
Mr. Clerk, please take the roll.
Jim Radecki?
Aye.
Mary Sino?
Aye.
Tom Simonian?
Aye.
Ron Singer?
Aye.
Mike Bruno?
Aye.
Tara Burkhart?
Aye.
Don Cummins?
Aye.
Dean Kilberg?
Aye.
Craig Maladra?
Maladra votes aye.
Richard Marks?
Aye.
Item 10, ladies and gentlemen, passes unanimously. We move on to items under 11, which is committee of the whole items of business. Item 11A is to consider ordinance number 2017-05, repealing ordinance number 2016-36, and ordinance amending Title I, Administration, Chapter 9, Municipal Taxes, of the General City of Geneva, of the Geneva City Code of Ordinances, and ordinance number 2016-66, and ordinance amending Title I, Administration, Chapter 9, Municipal Taxes, Article D, Places for Eating Tax, of the Geneva City Code of Ordinances.
Second.
Alderman Sino makes the motion. Alderman Marks makes the second. This matter is on the floor for discussion. From the dais, any comments? Alderman Maladra by phone, any comments?
No, sir.
No, sir. Alderman Radecki.
Well, I guess I'll lead off the discussion here. I suppose we're gonna have some. In the last, since last Monday, I've been in contact with most of the aldermen, either through email, individually, one at a time, the staff. Had the opportunity and the pleasure to meet with several of the people from the restaurant community to talk about the places for eating tax. In a nutshell, this is where I land with it, and this is the consideration that I'd like to throw out for the group to think about. Basically, I don't think that I know that the 2% that was originally proposed for the places for eating tax, in my opinion, was incorrect. Certainly the method and the way that we went about arriving at it and the communication was poor. We all pretty much agree on that. So now moving on to the tougher part, what do we do? I had floated the idea of a compromise of less than 2%. I threw some numbers around that I thought would generate enough just to cover the budget gap. And that was discussed individually with everybody and also with the restaurant community as well. At this time, I don't think that it's appropriate to repeal the places for eating tax for a couple of very basic reasons. The first one is that we don't really, we don't know what's going to happen with a lot of the variables that Stephanie started out with her presentation with the state. We don't know what the budget's going to be in the state. We haven't had one for 2 years. The delayed with shared revenues, the LGDF, the property tax. We have a lot of unknowns and a lot of variables with that. But also, I think it's interesting that our timing is that we are in the middle of the budget season right now, and until we agree of whether or not we can live without this tax, you know, it's irresponsible to either repeal it or put it into place right now. I think it makes sense to put it off to a date certain until we agree as a team whether or not the budget that has been proposed to us that we're going to massage for the next 30 or 45 days is acceptable. So, you know, how do we either repeal or institute a tax when we haven't even really established the budget just doesn't seem to make a lot of sense to me. But I also don't think that it's appropriate just simply to repeal it. I think we need to make that decision after we've agreed whether or not we can live with the revenue projections that we have right now and what impact that may have with our budget. So if that makes sense to anybody on this council, to me, it might sound a little bit like feeling strongly both ways, but I think it is the appropriate thing to do at this time. Thank you.
Alderman Bruno. Excuse me. Alderman Bruno.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, I'm in large agreement with Alderman Radecki. You know, going through this, you know, we've spent months talking about our capital needs, our infrastructure needs, and there was universal agreement as to what we needed to address that. We spent most of our time talking about how we would get that revenue. We had virtually no talk about that it wasn't really necessary. Suddenly a lot of votes flip, you know, and I'm hearing things like we seem to be doing fine. What we're doing is, by rescinding, we're kicking the can. I know there are many fans of Illinois legislature here. Illinois legislature kicked the can. I'm sure everything was running just fine. We can skip a pension payment here or there. It doesn't work out. You know, we've got snow plows failing. We have vehicles we can't put on a maintenance lift. You know, we've heard much impassioned concern from our restaurateurs, our revered and valued restaurateurs. We've had much discussion as to how we can ally those concerns. I wish we had more time to, during this entire process, you know, it rests with us that we started with PET, went off of PET. We lost a good bit of time to work with the restaurateurs. What I haven't heard is anything that refutes the data that we've seen on whether a PET is detrimental or not to the to restaurant attendance. It's easy, you know, I know it's easy to make statements to say no to this. It's you know, that type of thing works as a strategy. But I don't consider myself here to do trivially easy things. I think because of the reasons that Alderman Radecki stated, our genuine needs and the serious unknowns with the state of Illinois, I think it'd be an abdication of our duty to rescind the tax at this point. Now, that said, I'm very open to some significant compromise. I have my own loose framework for how we might make that work to fill the budget hole. I've got great interest in making sure the smallest businesses can afford the point-of-sale upgrades that they need. I'd like to divert some revenues directly to in support of the restaurant community. And I'm certainly open to pulling back from that 2% that Alderman Radecki mentions. If the vote comes to rescind tonight, I will vote against it. If there is a motion to delay so that we can strike a middle ground, I expect that I would vote yes. Thank you.
From the dais, Alderman Maladra.
Yes, sir. I also agree with Alderman Radecki, and I would add...
Can everyone hear Alderman Maladra? Okay, okay. Forgive me, it's Craig.
Sorry.
All yours.
All mine? Okay. I agree with Alderman Radecki, and I would just add that as the restaurant owners themselves had said, and as we discussed last week, we have been working with them and intended to continue to work with them on trying to find a compromise. I think that by postponing the rescinding, we gain the opportunity to continue that work. I don't know what date people have in mind, but like Alderman Bruno, if the vote to rescind comes up tonight, I'll vote against it. But if they vote to delay it until a date certain comes up, I would be in favor of that as well.
Alderman Cena.
I just, if we do repeal it tonight, is there some kind of time frame that it could be brought up again, or?
As I understand it, there's no statutory preclusion of when you can bring it up. It can be brought up any time.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else on the dais?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Singer? Alderman Singer, excuse me.
Thank you, sir. Alderman Radecki, the direction you're moving towards is, have you had a sense of consensus from the restaurant owners?
Well, they're here, and I wouldn't want to speak for them, but I will say that the meetings were very productive. They have absolutely indicated a willingness to work with the city. They want to understand what our needs are before they commit to that. And if I'm missing any of this, please, guys, fill in. But, you know, there was no commitment to a specific number or anything of that nature by them. And they have a large group that they need to communicate with, too. So I think that's how I would best describe it. But I would leave it up to them when we're done and it's turned over for their comments.
All right. Thank you for that clarification. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
And just to make certain I heard Alderman Radecki, you said the meetings were or the beatings?
Yes.
I know. I'm just Alderman Kilburg.
I appreciate Alderman Radecki's work on bringing this matter back with a different perspective. As I said last week, there were seven aldermen for it, three against when this initially came moved forward. I was one of those that was opposed. I really thought that our future rested with the sales tax increase, and that's why I opposed it. I continue to oppose it because I think when we discussed this initially, this was to be a stopgap, and that really, I think, the majority of the aldermen felt as though the sales tax increase is where we needed to be. But out of respect to our library, we decided that this was not the spring to run another referendum parallel to that, to give them every opportunity to air their need and see what the community's response would be. I agree with Alderman Radecki that I think what we do, rather than to rescind, is to delay. We did that once already. What's to prevent us from doing it again? Essentially, we pushed it back to May 1st. What's to say we couldn't push this back till October 1st? And at that point in time, as I said last week, we'll know the outcome of the library referendum and how the community feels about a referendum. It's been 10 years since the city of Geneva last considered a referendum here locally. And what will be the outcome? Where does the community rest on that issue? I think one thing that it's also unfair is the fact that we gave staff the charge essentially 90 days ago to move forward with a budget and an anticipated revenue from this, and now at the 12th hour, we're taking dollars away from the budget that they've worked on laboriously for a period of time, and now we're expecting them to create a balanced budget for us in a matter of about 2 or 3 weeks. Now, they've made an attempt at that, but I think that, you know, I think that out of respect to the staff, delaying this would serve a purpose as well. You know, I think the other issues as far as state funding and a lot of those things, as I said last week, the grand compromise. Will there be a grand compromise? And if it does, typically what happens is the state offloads it back on the school districts and on municipalities. That's how they balance their budget. And then all of a sudden they'll point the finger at municipalities and say, you know, why aren't these things happening? Well, we know why they're not happening. I'm in agreement with Alderman Radecki and to move this out to some date in the future, I think, for reconsideration. I would be in agreement with that. And I think at the same time, I think the council needs to get its arms around a potential sales tax increase and then start laying the groundwork and a plan to try to get that accomplished. The Chamber of Commerce had indicated that they would support that effort when they were here about six to nine months ago. I would hope that the restaurant owners would be in support of a sales tax increase as well, because I heard that last week from many of you, that that's the fair way to address this moving forward. So with that, thank you for your time, and that's all I have.
Thank you. Before I recognize Alderman Bruno for a second time, anyone who has not yet spoken, Alderman Burghardt.
I want to thank Alderman Radecki for keeping the conversations going with the restaurants after kind of a hot session last week. Can I ask what kind of timeline you're thinking? Alderman Kilburg's talking about maybe October. What's in your mind after talking to the restaurants, and how much time do we need to continue to have these conversations and maybe reach a compromise?
Well, this is just speaking for myself personally. I think October's too long. I think that is kicking the can down the road, because I think the farther that we do delay a decision with it, we are moving more towards the November of 18 potential referendum time. And then there is something to do, and I know Alderman Simonian's talked about this before, about the revenue stream and the timing, and when does the money actually come in, and you know, when we work out the details of it, I think the longer that we push it off, the less sense it makes to go with it. So I don't think that it would be a terribly difficult decision for us to make once we've gotten through the budget process to see where we're at, if we're willing to live with that. And then it's not terribly hard to make the calculation about what proposals we would want to discuss with the restaurant association or the restaurant group. So, I don't know that I have a date. You know, I'm thinking June 1, but it's just an arbitrary date. I don't know that this will take a protracted series. I think sometimes the more meetings we have, we meet to meet and they get drug out a little bit. I don't see the point in going to October, but I'm absolutely open to hear to anybody's comments with that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Alderman Burghardt, just and perhaps Alderman Radecki, better yet, as I understood it, there's percolating here a motion to postpone to a date certain, which could be as early as the next regularly scheduled city council meeting per statute, and or if we choose to hold a special city council meeting on the 27th or the 28th or the 29th, we could do that as well. I wasn't certain you were talking about delaying implementation so much as you were delaying or postponing final action to another meeting. Is that a fair assessment or no?
It's a long question. Could you rephrase that? There's a lot of information in that.
Are you talking about delaying implementation to a certain date, or just postponing discussion tonight and final action tonight to a certain
date? I'm saying delaying any kind of implementation and delaying rescinding it. I guess I'm speaking to only the motion on the floor right now.
Correct.
Is that I would not rescind it, but I guess I would entertain a friendly amendment, if that's appropriate, to delay the question to a date certain in the future which would be around June 1st.
There's two ways to do that. There could be a motion to table, which requires a second, and no debate is allowed, or there could be a motion to postpone to a date certain, which of course, discussion is permitted, but I will defer to the city attorney to make certain I've spoken accurately, which I suspect I have.
One night that I forgot to bring Robert's rules, but a motion to postpone is one intended to hold the subject matter for a limited time, but it can't be more than the next regular scheduled meeting of this body. A motion to table or lay on the table is more or less designed to kill the matter. You're really putting it aside because the only way it's going to come off is if there's a motion to remove it from the table. So it depends on your intent. If it's merely to delay consideration of item agenda 11A, then it'd be a motion to postpone. It requires a majority vote. Obviously requires a motion, a second. It is debatable, and it requires a majority vote. If you're going to lay it on the table, then it's a motion, a second. It's not debatable, and majority vote.
I'd make a motion to table.
Second.
There's a motion to table by Alderman Radecki. There's a second by Alderman Singer. No debate is permitted per Robert's Rules of Order, as explained by our city attorney. We will simply take a vote. Remember, a vote in the affirmative is to indeed table this matter.
We can revisit it at some point in time in the future.
Mr. Clerk.
Jim Radecki.
Aye.
Mary Sino. Tom Simonian?
Nay.
Ron Singer?
Aye. Yay.
Mike Bruno?
Aye.
Tara Burkhart?
Aye.
Don Cummings?
Nay.
Dean Kilberg?
Aye.
Craig Maladra?
Maladra votes aye.
Richard Marks?
Nay.
The motion to table, according to my record keeping, is 7 in the affirmative.
Six
in the affirmative, 4 in the nay category. The motion to table passes. The matter to, quote, repeal the ordinance has been tabled. We're at new business, ladies and gentlemen. Any new business by any member of the audience?
Can I speak about old business?
Of course. let me dispense of new business first. Anyone from the city council, new business? Alderman Simonian?
Is it okay to comment about the rescinding part in the new business?
Sure. It's new business, absolutely.
First of all, I wish I had the opportunity to speak before the motion was made.
If your hand was up, then I sincerely apologize for not recognizing
you. No, it was up, and but that's okay, no problem.
I
just want to say that delaying this does not change the fairness of this. We have not even gone through the budget process yet to decide anything. We gave consideration to the library when they came to us that we stopped this to provide a good relationship with the library and play nice. We didn't go have discussions with Delnor because we didn't want to damage those relationships. But yet, we're risking relationships with 90-plus restaurants here on something that, in my opinion, is not fair because we have not looked at all the avenues, and we don't even know how much we need. We don't know when we need it. This is a part of a cash flow issue. You don't need it on day one. You need it on, you know, the last month or the last 2 months. We don't know what's going to happen with this referendum, with the taste of the referendum is. And hanging this delay over the restaurant's heads is, in my opinion, a mistake. First of all, it's not fair. It's just not fair to take a small group like this and expect them to carry the general costs for the entire community. It's not fair, especially when we have other options, especially when we haven't even finished going through, we haven't even had one budget discussion yet. And it's just not fair to hang this weight over their heads. This should be rescinded. We should have budget, discussions. We should all agree what we need moving forward, and then all the different options available to us to generate that revenue, and then make a decision. This restaurant group has come before us and said they are willing to help any way they can when it's needed. But instead, we just want to delay it and delay it, and I think this is an absolute disgrace. As to, you talk about kicking the can down the road, we're kicking the can down the road, and I don't think it's fair. I really don't think it's fair. I know it's too late for my comment, but I don't think it's fair, and I'm very disappointed.
Under new business, Alderman Bruno.
Just a bit of information that kind of plays into our other conversations. I had the pleasure and opportunity to go down to Springfield with Metro West to lobby in front of our legislators for community issues. I bring that up because we keep talking about the referendum and, you know, laying it on. We didn't do it because of the library. There were other factors with that referendum. It does have intrinsically limited utility and could be, particularly after the year 2020. And I mentioned that because I did try and corner our legislators, and I got the inkling of support to remove some ambiguity or to remove or push back that sunset on a referendum on how those monies could be spent beyond 2020. So that I think that would change the entire calculus of what we pursue and when we pursue it and how we pursue it, if we can get that. Thank you.
I just want clarification.
Certainly.
No talking. So right now, as it stands, the way we did this, it goes in effect May 1st, correct? As 2%. Is that correct? Is that what
that
we
is
did
correct?
Tonight? Okay, I just wanted that
could
clarification.
Could be removed from the table. I mean, you could.
No. Right.
I don't know. I think we just did that.
From the audience, new business?
Is that correct?
That is correct, sir. Yes.
Correct. Okay. I just wanted
Mr.
to.
Okay. Here's some new business. I thought we just talked about the relationship we were going to build together. And you just put May 1 at a 2% tax back in our face. I'm totally disappointed. I want to first say, I don't have the mandate of the Food and Beverage Association. No one does at the moment. We haven't had time since any of these conversations have had to have a formal meeting. I'm going to expect, I've got a lot of agreement with me, but I want to make sure that if I do step on some toes, it's me, not the people behind me. We have stated our case clearly over a number of months. We're appreciative that you've been working with us. We think there has been more work in the last week than there has been in the months before. We remain believing this should be rescinded. Our reasons are clear. One, it's unfair and disproportionate to the restaurant and beverage industry. Two, it puts us at a competitive disadvantage with our neighboring communities and our competitors in those. Three, it will negatively impact our business. And if Mike Olson wants to come up and we want to talk about that, we can share with you some studies that were done, not newspaper articles. We're willing to do our fair share. None of us wants this community to do anything but ramp up, grow, be a wonderful place. We have our fortunes invested here. We're willing to do our fair share, but we keep asking, you know, what amount of money do you need? When do you need it? Do you need it from us alone? We've committed to have our resources to analyze the budget, see what's fair, see where there's some conservatism in some of those estimates. I hear today like the revenues are an absolute certain. I'm not sure I believe your sales tax number in your budget. It's conservative. But last I heard, you know, Federal Reserve Board raising their interest rate, a lot of people think there's going to be some economic growth happening. I don't see any of that built into your budget. So I will tell you that I've heard a lot about talk with the relationships of the library board. Out of respect to the library board, we'll not do this. Hear about the hospital. Out of our respect for our relationship, we won't do this. You are not respecting the relationship of 90 businesses in your community. And we're hearing we're at least third, if not further down the totem pole. I don't like it. I'm not going to stand for it. That said, I still would love to help you put in a 0.5% increase in the general sales tax. I'll commit my time and resources to the people behind me to help that happen. We'll help you support a home rule motion if you want to have the courage to put that forward, because that would allow you to do a lot of things you can't do now. And we certainly will help you look at the budget and figure out what the other alternatives are. I cannot believe this is the outcome of this evening based on the conversations we've had with a number of you the last week. This was the one thing that I was certain was not going to happen. So thank you very much for listening to me.
Alderman Radecki.
Well, first of all, I thought my position was very clear when we had a discussion yesterday, and this is exactly how I presented it today is how I presented it yesterday. So I think my position was clearly made yesterday. Second of all, it is not my intent, nor will I approve a 2% tax going into effect on May 1st. Yeah. That was not the intent of the, what, let me, that, it will.
Yeah. My reaction, Jim, is based on them saying that is exactly.
There was a technical question answered, or asked.
And that's
that
the
technical
correct
answer is yes, indeed. However, as we all know, because we've all schooled ourselves or have been schooled in Robert's Rules of Order, those voting in the affirmative to table this matter can, should they choose, offer a motion to reconsider this matter. All of you know that. So,
yeah, and it's,
excuse me for interrupting.
Yeah, and it's very simple. My statement still stands that we need to look at the budget. If we can live with it where it's at, then we should rescind this. Then somebody should bring this back up for consideration to rescind. And that is my intent. And if we can't, then we do have to explore all options. I understand how the restaurants feel, but I have obligations not only to the restaurant community, but I have obligations to about 40% of the people that live in Geneva in my ward to also represent their interests as well, too. So it's a balancing act. I'm still, the reason that I came forward with a compromise settlement, which seemed to be fairly well received, was that that would be my last-ditch effort, would be the compromise settlement. That's not my beginning point of negotiation. That's a, to me, that's a DEFCON. If we have to do this, that's what we would do. It is not my intent with this tabling to do that or to put a 2% tax on anybody. It's for us to have time to look at the budget and make sure that we, you know, rather than, we've already made enough mistakes with this. To me, rescinding it, then bringing it back, and then asking you for it is no worse or no better than taking it off the boards. So, thank you.
Alderman Cummings.
I was pretty excited tonight. I spent a good part of last week talking to a number of you and talking to a few of the aldermen about this. And I came in tonight and we had a balanced budget that didn't perhaps look exactly like everyone wanted it to look, but we had a balanced budget without the places for eating tax. I had good conversations from each of the restaurant owners, and each to a T was saying, no, I don't want this tax, very clearly. I could divide those no's into no's and hard no's being absolutely not, no room for negotiation. Three quarters, two thirds of three quarters were there. The rest were like, you know, we're having really good, substantive conversations right now. I think I'd be open to talking some more and working something out. It was a minority, but that was out there. And to a T, every single one of the restaurant owners also supported the sales tax, which I was really excited about. I thought, we get the chamber behind us, we get the council behind us, we get the city behind us, we get the restaurant owners behind us, the sales tax will go through. So I came in pretty excited. Alderman Bruno asked a question about something showing that this would hurt, a tax would hurt the restaurant industry. And if I'm remembering my Econ 101, that's called price elasticity of demand. What happens when the price changes to the demand for something? And if you are truly asking that question, one of the most famous studies was done by the University of Kentucky. And absolutely, like I said last week, there is a change in behavior and a change in demand when you price things differently, in small percentages, like a tax. It's frustrating to see a group that was on board with us to work together drift away because of this. Really, really disappointing. I was really excited tonight, and I'm disappointed.
Alderman Maladra on the phone, anything?
I would amplify Alderman Radecki's comments. I don't believe that the intent with this motion is to ram anything down anybody's throat or stop anything. I am hopeful that our discussions with the restaurant owners will continue and we will find a compromise that leaves everybody either satisfied or equally dissatisfied. I'm a little bit disheartened by what Alderman Cummings said, that there are restaurant owners out there who are saying, on the one hand, let's keep talking, let's find common ground, but on the other hand, are saying, as long as that common ground is what we want. I believe we're working towards compromise, and we need to continue that work, and I don't believe it will go on indefinitely. I believe that we are close. And I say we should just put our noses together and sit down, schedule some meetings, and work it through. Thank you.
Maybe I wasn't clear. At no point did a restaurant imply to me, or did I infer, or did they say that it's their way, the highway. So there was none of that that went on. When I was talking,
but we're talking over each other, gentlemen. So Alderman Cummings has the floor, and then
what I found when I talked to the restaurant owners was a willingness to continue to talk and work this out. And I would never assume that a continuation to talk means an acquiescence to 2%, or an absolute no on the 2%. I don't want to assume that. Maybe their suggestion will be, we're going to help you really hard on a sales tax. Maybe their suggestion would be, let us get into the budget because we have decades of experience with a top accounting firm. So I didn't want to imply that it was one or the other at all. Maybe Alderman Maladra misunderstood. I misspoke.
May I address that really quickly? I apologize, Don. What I was reacting to was your statement that the majority of the people you talked to were, in fact, hard no's, I believe was the term you used, and they don't want this tax in any way, shape, or form. If I misunderstood that statement, I do apologize.
Anyone else under new business? Thank you very much. Mr. Olson.
I'm the same.
Michael Olson, 202 North 6th Street. I am the owner of Stockholms in Geneva. Alderman Cummings made reference to a study that was done at the University of Kentucky, and they were specifically talking about a 3% tax they were proposing there. I think that the study that was done in Kentucky is relevant to our situation here for the following reasons. One, it was a 3% tax increase, which is rather similar to the 2% tax increase that is on the table. Two, the information in this study is reasonably current. It was done in 2013, so it's not like it was ancient history. The third fact is the demographics, the respondents in the study, while in the study for Kentucky, they said that it did not mirror the population of the state of Kentucky as a whole, that the respondents tended to be older, more educated consumers. I think that that does mirror those that we have here in Geneva and frequenting many of our restaurants. As a result, I think that points out that this study may have some greater relevance to Geneva. I certainly will not state that everything in this study is absolute. I have not double-checked or audited all the issues in the study. They did not only look at, you know, respondents from Kentucky, they also researched more than 30 other studies that had been done along this line as a part of this study. I'm going to highlight just two of those, and one of them referred to a study that talked about the impact of taxation on the restaurant industry. And in this particular study, they actually came up with a quantitative number, and they said that for every 1% increase in cost price, that there is a decline of 0.71% in purchases. This is the demand elasticity that Alderman Cummings was referring to. Let me translate that into numbers so that we understand where we're at. If a restaurant has food and beverage sales of $93.02, we then have a 7.5% tax on that. The gross total is $100. If we increase the tax by 2%, so the tax is now 9.5%, the restaurants are likely to see a 1.42% decline in revenue. So the restaurants will receive $92.36. The tax will, at 9.5%, will be $8.77. So the gross revenue will now be $101.13. So while on a gross revenue standpoint, it looks like, well, the tax didn't have a problem. There was no effect. We actually still saw more gross revenue. In fact, the restaurants lost 66 cents, while the government increased its revenue by $1.79. So there have been studies, and an increase in the tax will very likely hurt our bottom line. There were also other studies referenced where they talked about, it was in Virginia Beach, and this one was specifically a 2% increase that they did on the tax there, and they looked at the duration of these visitors staying in Virginia Beach. And with the 2% increase that they did implement there, they saw that the duration of this people's stay dropped by 0.1%. We state that we have 70% of our revenue comes from visitors to Geneva. We can debate whether it's 70%, 80%, but let's just, for argument's sake, say it's 70%. Do we want to risk even a portion of these visitors coming to Geneva? I think that this is a subject that warrants greater study, greater discussion, and I think we can find the right answer, but we do need to look at all of this information, not just this. I'm certain that there are other studies out there as well. Anyway, that would be, just wanted to share with you some specifics as I have been able to determine them.
I had a question. How did that study react to a 15, 18, or 20% tip request on the tab? Was there any consideration given to that?
Yeah, actually there was.
How did the consumer react to that?
I don't have that information pulled out specifically. The tip to the servers was reduced. I don't remember the exact number. I apologize for that, but it was reduced.
That's a lot. Much more significant percentage of the total tab at the end of the night than the 1 or 2% that we're talking about. Not that I'm arguing for the 2%, because I don't think that we're going to see that 2% tax enacted on May 1st, by the way. But I'm asking, a 20% tip on a $100 tab is a lot more money involved for the consumer than what we're talking about, though, right?
Yes. The study pointed out that there was a reduction in the tips. I don't remember what the number was. There were some other things in the study that were interesting from, I have my degree in economics, so
sure. You can
make all your jokes you want, they're all true. One of the things that I thought was very interesting is in the study, the data stated that, 80% of the respondents felt that the quality of service is what was most important in their decision making. But yet the data also showed that the independent full service restaurants were the ones that took the greatest hit, the greatest loss in business, which doesn't seem to make sense. Chain restaurants did better than full service restaurants, and all the way down the line to where buffet restaurants actually had no loss. So I don't know that the study is perfect. I'm only commenting on what the data is in the study, and I think that it warrants further look. That said, full service independent restaurants, according to the data that was determined in this study, do have a loss. Tips did go down. People did choose different dining venues, dining type establishments, as well as increasing eating at home.
What's the impact on a restaurant if the tips go down?
The impact is on the employee, the server.
And on our turnover.
Okay, thank you.
Alderman Bruno, then Alderman Bernhardt.
Thank you, Mayor. Just for clarity, I'm not specifically to you, but to everyone here and watching, I too believe that we will not see that 2% enacted. And if, as I understand it, parliamentary procedure gave us two options, tabling it as we did, or delaying it only to the next scheduled meeting, which I don't think gave us enough time for working with that. That's why I voted to table it, is just because we needed more time to work toward that in those discussions. Thank you.
Alderman Singer, did you want to be recognized?
No, thank you.
Alderman Maladra, Alderman Bernhardt, forgive me.
I agree with what's already been said. I do not think a 2% places for eating tax is going to take effect May 1st. I think between the two options we had, the tabling was the one that gave us this breathing room we need to get into the budget, continue to converse with the restaurants. Michael, can you say at the top, the study, what year it was, again, where we can find a copy, or can you send us a link, because I definitely want to dive into it. It definitely sounds like what we've been missing all these months of.
I feel sorry for you if you want to dive into it. It is the effects of restaurant tax and price increases, implications for managers, policymakers, and lobbyists. This was done through the University of Kentucky. The author was Junghee Han, that's J-U-N. G-H-E-E, last name H-A-N. It was dated 2013. The specific date, I believe, was sometime in October. October 15th.
I'm sure I can. Very good. Thank you very much. Thank you, Chair.
Submitted one to the clerk.
Alderman Cummings?
Thank you. I have just one sort of general comment I'd like everybody to think about, and it's a little bit of a quiz. Our 2017-18 budget, I believe the request is $96 million. 2015 budget was right around 90, I believe. I believe that the population in Geneva 2015 was around 21,800 people. We're looking for $90 million. Back in 2010, so 5 years earlier than that, two budgets, 2009-10 was 66.6 million, 2011 was 66.1, 2010-11. So 66 million and change back in 2010. We're looking for 96 million now. We have a population of 21,800. Does anyone want to hazard a guess what the population of Geneva was back in 2010? And admittedly, this may be...
It was more because 1,000 people were called cellmates who lived on Fabian Parkway.
2010, the official...
That's true, though.
Population was 21,495 versus 2015 estimate of 21,800. My point is, we are serving the same number of people and our budget's gone from $66 to $96 million.
God, I've seen that somewhere before, but what you're not taking into account is, as explained earlier in the budget process, more than two-thirds of the budget is enterprise funds, Alderman Malata, or excuse me, Alderman Cummings.
Understandable, and I'm absolutely not getting, and I do not mean to be get political about this at all, other than,
but I can answer
other than just these, where will we be if we keep pushing these taxes in and our population remains the same?
If we develop 400 acres of land that we all support in the Southeast Master Plan, we're going to see our budget blossom because of electric demand,
yeah,
water demand, wastewater demand, etc.
Now the enterprise funds are interesting, but if my thinking is right, if my memory serves me right, 100% of the people paying into the revenue of the enterprise funds live in Geneva.
Incorrect.
So, what percent?
100% of those who pay into the enterprise
City of
funds
Geneva.
Live in Geneva?
City of Geneva Electric. Let's say City of Geneva Electric. Let's say,
well,
the electric
we
fund.
We need to look only to the east, ladies and gentlemen, or only to the west. Burgess Norton, the president and CEO, and the majority of the employees do not reside in Geneva. Fona, the lion's share, if in fact any. In fact, I know two that live in Geneva. So when you talk about 100% of the users of our enterprise funds live in Geneva, that's a false statement. It's a false statement.
Who outside of the city limits of the City of Geneva is using City of Geneva Electric?
Well, you said residents who live in there only pay. That's how I heard you.
I know that every month I write a check to City of Geneva for electric. I know that every month part of that check goes for water and wastewater.
Right.
So those funds don't come from thin air. They are coming out of our pockets.
They're coming from
my
demand.
My point is, strategically, 30,000 foot level, if our budget has gone from 66 and change to 96 in 7 years, we'll be at 120 something in another 7 years. Will our population grow the same? And that's one of the things I worry about.
Well, this
and I'm
council
in favor
voted
of the
unanimously to approve
too.
A generating facility, unanimously approve a drinking water facility, unanimously, I think not quite unanimously, to approve $12 million in investments in the wastewater treatment facility. So if we're that concerned, and I'm general we,
yeah,
we have only to look at ourselves.
Not yeah. This council.
No, I didn't say, no, no I said good. Not this, you know.
I thought you just said this council agreed.
Well, we operate on a majority opinion here, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, but most of this council wasn't here for a lot of those decisions.
Okay, you're right. All hell's breaking loose, and you've proven your point.
Any more questions for me?
No, you can sit down.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is not new business, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
No, I have new business still.
Okay, new business.
I'd like to wish Alderman Singer a belated happy birthday. Yesterday was his birthday.
Yay.
The meeting is not adjourned. I recognize Brian Nord from the audience.
Thank you very much. My name is Brian Nord. I live at 122 North 4th Street. I had one question. I'm wondering, what was the document that was passed around by one of my fellow voters and citizens? Can I have one of those? Okay, thank you.
This is a document dated January 26, 2017, addressed to the council, signatures of folks requesting the rescinding of the places for eating tax.
My other question was, how many of the aldermen or alderpersons have met with the city administrator to discuss the budget in detail? Is there a number-ish? Is it everyone or is it not everyone?
No, not everyone.
So the other thing I want to just briefly address here is that to profess to care so much about the budget in detail and then say things like too busy campaigning to meet with the city administrator or to go into the budget in detail or to not understand, to do the homework to understand the budget, that's kind of disappointing. And those are words that I've heard from some people in the city council in the last couple of weeks. So I'm not saying I'm in favor of the PET. It sounds like there are creative solutions to be had here, and it sounds like there's time if people are not too worried about what the other things that are happening in the city are going on. There's time to put together a creative solution that maybe includes a sales tax. I'll help you get my fellow citizens to go with the sales tax if that's what needs to happen. But I'm not really excited to hear people do homework at the last minute or not do their homework at all and then come up here and say that what's happening is unfair. So I would expect more from some of my fellow citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else before the motion to adjourn? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Alderman Simonian makes the motion to adjourn.
Second.
Alderman Marks makes the second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Maladra?
Aye.
Unanimous to adjourn. Yeah. The meeting is adjourned.
Could you give the clerk a copy of what you passed around?